Good evening. It's a proud privilege for me to welcome you all to the Infosys Prize lecture being delivered today by the renowned historian, Dr. Prachi Deshpande. Prachi, who happens to be a dear friend, teaches history at the Center for Studies in Social Sciences, Kolkata, for the last 11 years. Prachi has completed her doctorate in history from Tufts University in the USA, and has taught at various universities such as the University of California, Berkeley, Rutgers, and Colorado State University. Prachi has contributed several articles to research publications in social sciences and history. Her book, Creative Pasts, is a treat for readers who are interested in history as well as memory studies. Prachi is the recipient of the 2020 Infosys Prize for the Humanities. The Infosys Prize is an annual award established by the Infosys Science Foundation to honor outstanding achievements of researchers and scientists across six categories of sciences. Each prize carries a purse of $100,000, a gold medal, and a citation. The talk today is a part of the Infosys Prize lecture series. These are public talks delivered by the Infosys Prize laureates and jurors. The lecture series covers a wide range of topics on the cutting edge of science as well as research. The lectures aim to inform the public and inspire young researchers and students to make their passion their profession. Prachi is delivering her Infosys Prize lecture this evening, and it is entitled Microhistories of Multilinguality. If the listeners have any questions for Dr. Deshpande as she delivers her talk, please requesting you to send these questions, comments by tagging the Twitter handle at Infosys Prize, InfosysPrize. You can also type the questions in the comment box. So, on behalf of the Department of History, Savitribai Phule Pune University, and the Infosys Science Foundation, I now request Professor Prachi Deshpande to deliver her lecture. Prachi.
Thank you, Shraddha. Thank you for this generous introduction and welcome. I'm delighted and honored that this talk is being hosted by the Savitribai Phule Pune University. I'm especially honored about speaking at the history department, even if virtually. I've received a lot of help and guidance from the faculty at the Department of History at SPPU since my PhD research days, from the days of Professor Yar Kulkarni, Professor Sumitra Kulkarni, yourself. My father, Hanuman Deshpande, did his PhD from this very department under the guidance of Professor K.N. Chitnis many years ago. And Professor Chitnis's own work has been invaluable for me in this project as I've embarked for the first time to work with Kannada materials and Northern Karnataka. So this is invoking many genealogies and it's a special moment for me in many ways. And I thank you and the Infosys Science Foundation for the opportunity to speak from this platform for my prize lecture. So I'll start now. Can we start the slides, please? One day in early 1701, a wealthy landowner and moneylender, Narasingh Rao Ramaji, had four documents written up in Marathi in the cursive Modi script. Two of these documents were Krayapatras, or deeds of sale. They recorded the sale of various shares in the Patilki, or headmanship, of the village of Saushi from Narasingh Rao and three others to Kenchan Gowda, the Desai of Lakshmeshwar. Lakshmeshwar is today in the Dharwad district of Northern Karnataka, not far from Saushi. Kenchan Gowda was the local chieftain and a substantial political figure at the time of this transaction. A third letter provided details of other matters also transferred to the Desai, such as outstanding debts and all the associated paperwork. In the fourth document prepared that day, Narasingh Rao wrote to another local authority, Lingan Gowda, the Nad Gowda of Kundgol, apprising him of these sale transactions. Judging from the handwriting, all four documents were written by the same scribe and signed by the same two witnesses. And you can see one of those documents on the screen here today. We'll come back to it. These four documents are part of the Lakshmeshwar Desai Daftar, the largest among many such household daftars of Desais from the Dharwad area, now in the archives of the Bharat Itihas Samshodhak Mandal in Pune. These daftars are multilingual and contain documents in Perso-Arabic, Modi, and Kannada scripts. The Mandal's legendary curator, Ganesh Hari Khare, collected these daftars in the early 20th century from larger repositories in family collections and published some of them in the sixth volume of the Shivacharitra Sahitya series in 1937. What is available as the Lakshmeshwar Desai Daftar today was shaped by what generations of the family thought fit to preserve, the ravages of war and time, Khare's own curating framework, and the Mandal's subsequent archiving methods. As such, the Lakshmeshwar Daftar is necessarily incomplete, even beyond the general caveat about the fragmentary and incomplete nature of all archives. In today's talk, I take up these documents and this household archive to probe the deployment of language and script in early modern documentation practices in South Asia and pose some questions about multilingual scribal practice. Multilinguality is ubiquitous in every aspect of Indian life, but it is also effaced from the standardizing narratives of modern linguistic nationalism. It figures in warm and fuzzy descriptions of a unity in diversity picture of India, a happy profusion of tongues disciplined into a formal federal structure, an approved schedule of scripts. Yet this profusion also emerges in the rhetoric of policymakers in education and administration, primarily as a problem to be managed. Neighboring states find bilingual border regions especially problematic and fight over and try to discipline their polyglot disorder with neat boundaries on the ground, in institutions, and as we are seeing of late, ever more violent measures. A textured cultural history of the South Asian past has, however, emphasized the multiple relationships and porous boundaries between languages, the contingent histories of linguistic categories, and large transregional linguistic formations, such as the Sanskrit cosmopolis or the Persianate world. Histories of the circulation of ideas, texts, and people have identified points of contact and border zones, not as problems or mystics, but as productive sites for exploring the making of identities and publics, as well as linguistic hierarchies and the exertion of power. Niall Green has recently argued for thinking about persographia, the domain of written rather than oral Persian within the Persianate world, for parsing the messiness of borrowing and conflict between Persian and localized linguistic and writing practices. Nandini Chatterjee's microhistory of a Zamindari family of Malwa from the heyday of the Mughal Empire to the 19th century has highlighted the multiple languages and scripts that were folded into an enduring Persianate documentary regime, and which undergirded and linked local authority to imperial power structures. Chatterjee's close reading of language use in scribal practices is an important provocation to unpack the often used but sweeping term language of administration in describing bureaucratic power and practice. Francesca Orsini's programmatic call for investigating multilingual locals in literary cultures also invites us to consider how focusing on material conditions of speech and writing can help us see how the local and the transregional intersected in particular texts and mediums. So the title of my lecture today, Microhistories of Multilinguality, also highlights my close engagement with these arguments and insights as I explore the Lakshmeshwar Daftar, and I will return at the end to the ways in which debates within microhistory may or may not help us think through these questions of the local, the transregional, and the multilingual in scribal practice. The next slide, please. The region in today's northern Karnataka is in the Krishna Tungabhadra Doab was under Adilshahi rule from the 16th century. The Marathas and later the Mughals held sway in the late 17th century after the demise of the Adilshahi. And the region remained a bone of contention in the 18th between the Nawab of Sawnur, the Peshwa, and the Nizam of Hyderabad. The Peshwa directly administered parts of this territory, but also farmed out sections as jagirs to various Maratha sardars. Amidst all this, long-standing local desais, such as Kenchan Gowda of Lakshmeshwar, controlled small territories known as desgats and a variety of revenue collection positions and procedures at the Pargana and village levels, negotiating local control with various incoming powers. This overall region, stretching for the east towards Solapur and Pandharpur, was already markedly bilingual in the socio-cultural spheres. As the work of Guntha Santhaimar and R.C. Dhere, and more recently Elaine Fisher, Dushan Deak, Pushkar Soni, and many others has persuasively shown, this was a broad meeting zone of enduring pastoral, literary, and devotional cultures that found rich expression in Marathi, Kannada, as well as in Dakhni. The next slide, please. The administrative documentation in this region was also layered. Under Adilshahi rule, Persian was the court language and used for issuing farmans, and Marathi, singly and bilingually with Persian, became, in G.H. Khare's words, the preferred secondary court language, even in the broadly Kannada-speaking regions of this Doab from the 16th century. Khare attributed this to the scribal establishments of Maratha chiefs, which migrated south of the Krishna to administer lands in this area that the Adilshahi court had given these chiefs in Jagir. Village-level records were kept in Kannada in a scribal hand that has also come to be called Kannada Modi. So you can see, in this slide, you have a bilingual document in Persian and Marathi. You have a single sort of Marathi only document, which is a Kaulnama from the 17th century, and you have a Kannada document, a letter that is written in this Kannada, what is called now the Kannada Modi script. This is not a cursive script like the Marathi Modi one, as the letters are scribed separately, but they are modified to enable speedier writing and require some skill to read. These scribal hands likely evolved gradually from the Halekannada script as Kannada documentation expanded from stone and metal to several localized forms on paper and on kadatas, the blackened rolls of cloth, which were written on with soapstone styluses. Kadatas were also widely used for preserving copies in cursive Kannada of inscriptions and paper documents in household and institutional collections, as A.K. Shastri has shown in his meticulous compilation of the Sringeri and Chitrapur Matha archives in the Malnad region. A distinct variant of this writing system known as Goi Kannadi, distinct enough that the similarities are visible but not immediately legible, was also in use for local bureaucratic documentation in Konkani from at least the 16th century in the old conquest areas of Goa. So documentation in Kannada script had an enduring tradition localized to particular language usage and multiple media. So in this presentation now, for the rest of the time, when I say Marathi and Kannada documentation, I'm referring to writing in the respective Modi scripts. In the later 17th century, Shahaji Bhosle extended Adilshahi power further south into the Karnataka, the region around Mysore, and Marathi documentation began there too at the Pargana levels. It also came deeper into the peninsula with the establishment of the Maratha state at Tanjore. A mixed Persian and Marathi revenue vocabulary also trickled steadily into village-level Kannada documentation. K.N. Chitnis observed that in many documents of the Desai Daftars of this Doab, even though the script was Kannada, the writing was, quote, so full of Marathi and Persian revenue terms that one doubts it to be the Kannada language. Marathi nationalists of the early 20th century viewed the influx of Persian into Marathi bureaucracies as akin to an invasion. But their Kannada contemporaries viewed both Persian and Marathi as imperial invasions into Kannada. I hope to show that all these linguistic histories are inextricably, somewhat unexpectedly intertwined. The next slide, please. Okay. So let us zoom into the Desai dafters once again to consider language and script distribution across the available documents. And I invite you to soak in some of the detail with me. Broadly, documents that issued various kinds of grants to the Desais by the Adil Shahi and Mughal regimes are bilingual in Persian and Marathi. The specific deployment of both languages depended on the type of grant document. So imperial farmans were almost entirely in Persian with perhaps a line of Marathi. However, in documents such as the Kaulnama, which were deeds of assurance or permissions for cultivating wasteland, the Persian content was usually relatively brief, and a longer version with more details followed below in Marathi. This detail, often designated in the Persian section merely as Mutabik-e-Hindavi, ensured that the instructions were understood and undertaken in the concerned village and cross-checking by lower-level revenue collectors who usually did not read Persian. This graphic arrangement and brevity also underscored the symbolic power of Persian. There were also Marathi-only grant documents issued by the Adil Shahi and Maratha administrations, but in these two, the Marathi prose was heavily Persianized. After 1674, the year of Shivaji's coronation, there was a distinct shift in the formal structure of Maratha documentation. The earlier Persianized preambles, such as Ajarakta Khane or Mashur al Anam, changed to more Sanskritized phrases, such as Akhandita Lakshmi Alankrita, etc. Dates in the Shaliva Hanshake, in addition to sometimes instead of the Suhur era, and Sanskritized names of the week and month. Despite this change in the framing apparatus, however, formulaic Persian phrases continued in the body of the correspondence between Maratha officials and the Desais. Bilingual documents where the Persian content was also elaborated in Kannada rather than Marathi are comparatively rare in the Desai dafters. There are also no bilingual Marathi-Kannada documents of this type. At best, we find the occasional Kannada signature of a witness or marginalia on a Marathi document and vice versa. Marginalia in both languages, however, was present on Persian documents. For example, 1648 Adil Shahi Farman in Persian to Hanuman Gowda Guttal, the Deshpande of Jamkhandi, had the recipient's name in Marathi on the back, but it also had a brief explanation of the text in Kannada, a firmana to go consult with Khan Muhammad Wazir. Another Desai daftar, that of the Kallapur Desais from the 1620s, interestingly, has a few trilingual and triscriptural documents, also kaulnamas. These trilingual kaulnamas preserve this representation of linguistic hierarchy and scribal segmentation, not only between the Persian and the Marathi, but also between the Marathi and the Kannada, with a shorter Marathi section followed by a much longer one in Kannada. The symbolism of authority through brevity and hierarchy, therefore, was reproduced here too. And it tells us that in the 1620s, at least, there were scribes in the Kallapur Desai's territory or household daftar who might not have been literate in Marathi. Now, the onus of preserving original documentation relating to a wide variety of rights, permissions, and grants that made up property in this period, which in Marathi is encapsulated by the time by the term bhogavata, literally consumption, was on the recipients of the paperwork rather than the grantors or a centralized chancery or a public archive. Local power holders across the Western Deccan, like the Lakshmeshwar Desai, held a variety of nested rights to land and produce and administrative positions and emoluments that they managed through large households of extended kin, dependents, and employees. The household level daftar or office thus implied both the physical workspace of writing and land management as well as the end product of the work of bureaucratic documentation. So many historians in the early 20th century regularly sifted and printed documents from such household collections as the so-and-so family daftar, with the underlying implication that these were parcels of a large, coherent and centralized Maratha archive. But this right and responsibility of preserving the archive of the Bhogavata was frequently in tension with centralizing bureaucratic power, as any change in the power structure, the arrival of a new official, change in government, war, famine occasioned negotiations over local rights all over again, and thus a renewal of paperwork too. All the documents regarding Narasingh Rao's transaction with Kenchan Gowda were preserved in the Lakshmeshwar Daftar because the village Saushi was one of the Desai's hereditary inam or rent-free villages. This inam was granted by the Adil Shahi, but also confirmed in 1679 in a Marathi document by Shivaji. The documents mark the growing consolidation of the Desai's local authority as he gathered more shares in hereditary offices as well as control over local debt relations. These household daftars thus had yielded a wealth of empirical information about the socio-economic history of the area. However, since many of them were sifted and printed selectively in the colonial period, usually to foreground documents of political or military importance, we often don't get a sense of their overall in situ organizing logic, as it were. So as I said earlier, what remains of the daftar today is necessarily incomplete. Tracking the languages of marginalia and annotations on Persian documents in them, however, gives us some idea of this organization. Documents with Kannada annotations were more likely to be made in daftars where the scribes were more familiar with Kannada than with Marathi. As we saw earlier, the prized documents like Farmans often had these brief one-line explanations in Kannada, presumably by and for the use of such scribes. But it's likely that as familiarity with Marathi deepened in the village-level scribal world, the need for such Kannada annotations was no longer felt. And we can track that through some of the documents. Some of the Kannada documents in the Lakshmeshwar Daftar additionally appear to be numbered lists of documents that may have been part of a cataloging practice. So you have kind of titles like papers relating to Dilek Khan Sahib, papers about the negotiation of Bibnor. And one document lists and enumerates all the papers about Narasingh Rao Ramaji Saushi, which includes all of these documents that we saw in the beginning. And so this suggests to me that although a multilingual establishment, Kannada was the organizing language of the Lakshmeshwar Daftar and the primary language of its scribal establishment. So far, we have seen Persian, Perso-Marathi, and Marathi documents. What are the Kannada documents in this collection like? Many of them are Krayapatras, records of land transactions between the Desai and other landholders, and some correspondence with village officials. A couple are named as Krayanama. These Kannada Krayapatras generally follow the formal structure and vocabulary of medieval Sanskrit Kannada inscriptions. For example, they begin with preambles such as Swasti Sri Jayabhyudaya, or more commonly, the elaborate Shaivite salutation, Namastunga Shirashchumbi Chandra Chamara Charavi. Some documents feature both phrases. None of these documents, Kannada documents, bear seals of local officials, but they were nearly always witnessed and signed by other villagers, almost always in Kannada script. Therefore, at the time that Narasingh Rao and Kenchan Gowda's transaction took place in 1701, language practices at the level of the Desai household daftar remained broadly segmented by genre and to some extent locality. Perso-Marathi vocabulary and writing conventions, however, had gradually seeped into this delimited domain of Kannada documentation over the previous century. One of the enduring markers of this influence, Chitnashod, was the appearance of compound words that combined old terms with their new equivalents. For example, local Kannada documents increasingly deployed the term Pargana alongside the older Kannada administrative unit, Sime. They also incorporated the practice of abbreviating recurring terms such as Pa, with two lines for Pargana, or Ra with two lines for Rajashri, as was the case practiced in Marathi documents, and began noting the Suhoor era alongside the Shalivahan Shake era. In the 18th century, we see that rather than whole blocks of text that stretch the width of the paper, letters in Kannada also began to adopt narrower lines for preambles of letters at the top. Narasingh Rao's four Marathi letters then allow us to see this segmentation and these shifts up close. So let us now return to them. Can we have the next slide, please? Yeah. The Marathi sail leads from this period, from further north, north of the Krishna, are almost always named as Kharedikhat or Kharedikhat. Narsingh Rao's 1701 documents unusually named them as Krayapatras, like their Kannada equivalents. Moreover, they note the patrilineal descent of the named parties in the style of the Kannada Krayapatras rather than the established Perso-Marathi convention. So, for example, it notes Yelap Gowda's lake Kenchan Gowda, Yelap Gowda's son Kenchan Gowda, as if it were a translation of Yelap Gowdan Maga Kenchan Gowda, rather than Kenchan Gowda Wald Yelap Gowda or Kenchan Gowda bin Yelap Gowda, as it would be Kenchan Gowda, the son of Yelap Gowda. And that's repeated throughout the documents. Kundgol is glossed as a Sime rather than a Pargana, but abbreviated in the Marathi style. How do we make sense of these variations? My hunch is that these documents were initially drafted as Kannada documents, much like Krayapatras usually were, and then translated into Marathi. A somewhat shaky hand and crossed out letters in a few places in a couple of documents hints that this may well have been the work of a scribe who was more used to writing in Kannada than Marathi. It's reasonable to assume that both parties involved were familiar with both languages and scripts, and yet the sale transaction was documented in Marathi. Did the increased presence and prestige of Marathi documentation due to Maratha control of this region after the 1680s prompt this choice of Marathi? Perhaps Kenchan Gowda Desai felt that in any future disputes or the recovery of unpaid dues or document scrutiny, it would be easier if they were indeed in Marathi. If this was so, the greater prevalence of the Kannada Krayapatra form in local scribal knowledge imprinted its ghostly presence, as it were, on these Marathi documents. Or does the choice merely reflect Narsingh Rao Ramaji's own location primarily in Marathi rather than Kannada, and thus a personal preference? Our only clues to this location from these documents are the suffixes to his name, Ramaji rather than Ramaya, or Narsingh Rao rather than Narsingh Rayaru, which might indicate a location in primarily Kannada. Identifying such a location in this intensely bilingual region itself is a slippery proposition, because while there's evidence of language preference, for example, the language and script in which witnesses chose to sign their names or in marginalia, it's a leap from such preferences or a primary language to something like a mother tongue that suggests a conscious and complete identity or affiliation. So these individual documents do not offer definitive answers, but they offer us a trace of the ways in which Kannada forms and practices also crept into Marathi rather than simply the other way around, as the historiography has it. In Mughal Malwa, Nandini Chatterjee shows how Muslims and Hindus both recorded local transactions and non-official entitlements and obligations in Persian forms, such as Bayanama, Rehennama, Farikkatis, Tamasuks, and frequently had them notarized by local qazis. Such non-official documents enabled other languages and scripts to enter Persian documentary space, but the use of Persianate and Islamic legal forms for such transactions also indicates the widespread belief in what she calls Persians' authenticating capacity beyond the official domain of royal orders and tax contracts. In other words, the preference for signing names in different scripts went hand in hand with the wish to record the actual transaction itself in Persian. The multilingual scribal world of the Lakshmeshwar Daftar reveals this deep regional reach of the Persianate into the Krishna Tungabhadra Doab, but also reveals its limits. Here, non-official transactions did not take place in Persian alongside farmans and other orders. They were rooted in an established Kannada scribal culture. However, Marathi record keeping bore a strong Persianate imprint, and it was overall a deeply intertwined Perso-Marathi documentary formation that encountered the Kannada scribal world in the Dharwad region. The Lakshmeshwar papers show us that this encounter initially produced a language hierarchy with Persian at the top and local writing in Kannada at the bottom, with Marathi facilitating the state's reach into the countryside and the transfer of resources from the countryside into the state's coffers at various levels. By the early 18th century, the nature of this tripartite encounter changed. The lexicons like the Rajvyavahar Kosh, which prepared Sanskrit alternatives for Perso-Arabic bureaucratic terminology, the independent Maratha state attempted unevenly to disentangle Marathi bureaucratic writing from Persian. At the same time, Marathi forms and conventions also pressed on existing Kannada ones. So under Peshwa rule, supervisory record keeping from this region, now in the Karnataka Jamav section of the Peshwa Daftar in Pune, was almost entirely in Marathi. That's possibly why there are very few Kannada documents from this period in the Lakshmeshwar Daftar itself. The Marathi scribal manuals, known as Mestaks, were geared towards this level of supervisory record keeping in the 18th century. The Mestaks provided middling revenue officials, such as Kamavisdars, with practical guidelines for doing their jobs. One text, the Pishacha Lipika from the mid-18th century, when the Maratha state was beginning to expand into different regions, emphasizes the need for the scribe to be alert to local or Deshi variations in names, measures, taxes, and products to ensure that he is not being cheated by local authorities. However, the manual doesn't name these variations. It merely observes that there are innumerable desh between the Sindhu and the Tungabhadra and asks the scribe to be alert to their infinite variety. It thus invokes desh not as a bounded ethnocultural or linguistic zone, but as a unit of difference for localized bureaucratic and agrarian practice. For the Peshwas Kamavisdars who came into the Doab then, engaging with this diversity involved more than just knowing Marathi or Kannada. It involved a familiarity with a much more localized vocabulary, one that often spanned both languages plus Dakni, and which one might call interlingual everyday practice. The revenue scribes had to translate such local vocabulary orally and then into their written reports. Translation here could mean different things. It could mean converting measures for calculating taxes or calendars for annotating documents. It could also mean transcribing the same technical vocabulary from one script and grammatical framework into another for circulation within different graphic domains, either for skill reasons or for ideological reasons. The language use and shifts in formal features and phraseology that I outlined in Narsingh Rao's Krayapatras and other documents in the Lakshmeshwar archive allow us to see some of these contrary currents through which Persianate jargon came into local writing and local terms moved from their immediate context into a broader bureaucracies and thence into wider language use. This documentary evidence, divided into different languages and scripts, nevertheless gives us the overall impression that the multilingual landscape was made up of separate spheres, not only of skill and circulation, but by extension of sociality, community, and individual identity. This graphic compartmentalization hints at the larger and more diverse oral domain the Mestak cautions the scribe about, but doesn't allow us to fully grasp this interlingual orality. This is both the attraction and the challenge of working with such local materials to understand multilinguality historically. Francesca Orsini, Christian Nowetzki, and others have shown in great detail how contexts of performance help us approach this continuum of orality between established literary languages or dialects. And I think it's worth looking at how testimonial genres like the Qatba or the Kaifiyat captured oral testimonies in local speech forms in front of judicial assemblies into formulaic phrases and contributed to making a Perso-Marathi bureaucratic register intelligible over a larger area over time. But the framework of performance is not really available to explore the oral penumbra of such documentary genres or the oral workly space of translation in the scribal daftar. How then do we read this oral penumbra beyond the edge of the page, as Giovanni Levi famously put it in his description of the microhistorical method? recent scholarship on the Deccan Sultanates by Philip Wagner, Richard Eaton, Roy Fischel, again Pushkar Soni, Emma Flatt, has insightfully shown the ways in which these states engaged the sphere of the local to create a political language all their own by incorporating older architectural elements to root themselves in a larger cultural memory, or by using vernacular languages for administrative documentation in addition to Persian. But fleshing out this vernacular in terms of language distribution or in terms of these interlingual practices remains challenging. This is partly because the local tends to become a placeholder for everything that remains in archival shadow. And it's also because of the weight of modern frames of linguistic states, or what we might call maximal languages. And I use the term maximal in the way that Sumit Guha has used it to capture large social groupings of religion or caste, broad brush categories of identification that upon zooming in, pixelate into smaller and smaller categories of jati, sampradaya, occupation, and state practice. These maximal categories, he shows, have dense socio-political meaning, but the lived experience and bureaucratic reality of community life are in these smaller groupings, which allow us to see the cracks in the making of these umbrella-like formations. So maximal categories of language, similarly, we might say, are certainly discursively and materially real, and took distinct forms over centuries in literature and administration. But the lived experience of language in local speech forms that are classed as local dialects of larger languages, but often spill over messily across larger formations. Recent debates in microhistory have reanimated some classic methodological questions, the ways in which the microscope and the bird's eye view interact, the importance of what Eduardo Grandi called the exceptional normal in readjusting our historiographic lenses, as it were, and the value of scalability in historical analysis. This methodological debate about the value of a reduction in scale has actually been prompted by the dramatic expansion in scale of studies, of things as diverse as commodities, thoughts, and people in global history. And it's generated both cautionary as well as hopeful questions about the possibility of a global microhistory, one that addresses the making of an interconnected and interdependent world, but does not sweep up all complexity and contradiction in its narrative wake. Is the biographical arc often of unusually cosmopolitan individuals against the background of cultural contact and conflict the best way to humanize or localize large institutional and structural frameworks? Or is a close tracking of the multilingual journey of documents the best way to flesh out granular contexts? Does the reduction of scale merely ratify larger structures with greater detail, or must scalability reformulate the relationship between the local and the general? All these questions give us, I think, much to think with in characterizing the linguistic local, its relationship to larger social and administrative structures in the early modern subcontinent, and the ways in which modern categories of the linguistic state both enable as well as hobble a historiography attentive to difference and diversity. As I noted earlier, Marathi nationalist historiography has seen the Marathi-Persian relationship as one of conflict and force, and Persian has remained, in a sense, external to the overall narrative of Marathi language history. And in the case of Kannada, this is applied to both Persian and Marathi. But through the close look at the scribal sphere in the Dharwad region through the Lakshmeshwar archive, however, we are able to plot the Persianate in the peninsula not simply as a Persian local binary or a Persian vernacular binary, but as one where different languages spread and interacted at different scales. Across the 18th century, Marathi, written in the Modi script, inserted itself into many regions, attracted many scribes, and performed critical functions in many administrations. This was largely due to its ability to either adapt to or be a vehicle for Persianate forms. Although projects like the Raj Vyavahar Kosh were formulated to give Marathi a transregional boost through Sanskrit vocabulary, This PersianNet legacy greatly propelled this transregional deployment, particularly deeper in the peninsula. So rather than shoehorn this transregional history into frames of cosmopolitan or vernacular, a scalar approach that focuses on different domains of use and reach through such micro studies of documentation might instead allow us to better connect local language use to transregional formations, whether this be the PersianNet or the Maratha Empire. What if we look ahead into the colonial period? Over the early 19th century, the Krishna-Tungabhadra Doab came to be called the Southern Maratha Country after the British took it over from the Marathas. Later, it became the Southern Division of the Bombay Presidency. The colonial state initially continued the Peshwa use of Marathi in the administration and opened only Marathi schools. From the 1830s, however, it started Kannada schools and the use of Kannada as the language of public business. Under the Rayatwari system put in place in the region, the state extracted revenue directly from peasants rather than through zamindari middlemen. And in this framework, the colonial state came to view the use of Marathi in this largely Kannada-speaking region as contrary to Rayatwari principles and a hindrance to efficient checks on subordinate native clerks. So Kannada literacy was first encouraged and then required for subordinate clerks in the collectorate and then for district and village accountants. And the new Kannada schools aimed at directing their attention to Kannada record keeping rather than Marathi, which many of them had been used to in previous decades. This discourse of education also took place overwhelmingly under the rubric of separate social spheres of language rather than bilingual or multilingual skill. The parallel growth of Kannada medium schools and primers from the mid-19th century gradually increased the volume of Kannada bureaucratic documentation across different genres and spaces. Can we have the next slide, please? Thank you. So you can see a few Kannada scribal manuals from the 19th century over there. These manuals geared towards letter writing forms, accounting genres, and other such vyavahara lekhana or business writing in Kannada appeared in this region from the 1860s. Although Kannada primers and manuals of documentary genres were already available in Madras or Mysore by the time, many of these regional vyavahara lekhana texts were modeled on contemporary Marathi publications of the time and prompted by examination syllabi and requirements. Kannada print circulation was thus still localized, and the interlingual transactions likely continued in everyday scribal practice. Still, as Kannada medium and Marathi medium education further diverged over the colonial period, their print spheres and language practices were undergirded by divergent historical identities for each language, ranging from their linguistic evolution in distinct language families to their literary and cultural histories. The physical, social, and cultural spheres of circulation of both languages in the Dharwad region continue to overlap intensely, you know, through music, literature, religious practice, and scholarship. But the administrative domination of Marathi in a largely Kannada-speaking area became one of the sort of overriding factors for the Karnataka Ekikaran movement, which started in this very region. So eventually, Ekikaran and Sanyukta Maharashtra produced two linguistic states with a richly bilingual but heavily contested northern border zone. Like many other such contested border zones, the archives and histories of the region that I have outlined here have fallen between the cracks of the dominant historical narratives and archiving practices of both states. Paper documents in Kannada Modi, interspersed with a Marathi archive of Maratha control in such household archives, are peripheral to the Kannada regional narrative at whose core are inscriptions and an earlier literary history. The Marathi regional narrative, seeking evidence of Maratha political and military glories, mostly set aside these Kannada documents with their local land sales and correspondence as not being of much historical value. So for decades, they lay unread, even after many Marathi documents from the same archives were transcribed and printed. And again, Chitnis was one of the few who used them together for a dense and locally attentive socioeconomic history. Of course, our ability to revisit these multilingual and multi-scriptural archives is also structured by our own modern monolingual or Anglo-vernacular regimes of formal education, with multilinguality at best a part of informal settings rather than the cornerstone of historical research and training. Microhistories of multilinguality then force us to confront the messiness of process embedded in the flat phrases, languages of administration, or the local vernacular. And parsing these phrases is necessary not only to be able to zoom in to a better resolution from top-down catalogs of archives or maps of states or regions and communities, but also to confront the difficulty of actually acknowledging and incorporating these conceptual variations into long-term narratives of language, of regionality, and of linguistic identity. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Prachi. Lovely expositions. I resonate with what you have said, Prachi, because as one studies the documents and the archival materials from the Middle Ages or the medieval period, one is really amazed at the way in which different linguistic practices were negotiated by the authors, not just of these official documents that you have chosen here, for example, but in literary spheres as well. Just recently, I came across somebody who called himself Kavikula Sulatana. So Kavikula Sulatana and Kavi Patashah. So I don't think they saw the boundaries as, you know, as watertight as we see them today. So lovely exposition. Thank you, Prachi.
Thank you.
We've started having a few questions here. And I'll read out the first one, which comes from Balaji. Literary histories tend to claim that the Dakhni Sultanates, such as the Adil Shahi, worked to muzzle literary creations in Marathi. How far do these claims hold water? So was it a dark age under the Dakhni Sultanates, as far as creative writing in Marathi was concerned?
Muzzle is a very, very strong word. We do not have evidence of the Adil Shahi Sultanate patronizing Marathi literary production or Marathi poetry at the court, like, for instance, the Qutub Shahi Sultanate did with Telugu. A lot of scholars who have written on the Deccan Sultanates and the ways in which they engaged with regional languages in the region have identified that as one of the contrasts between the Adil Shahi and the Qutub Shahi. And there are many sort of different reasons for the ways in which localism or vernacularity was understood differently by the Adil Shahi and the Qutub Shahi. But I don't think there is evidence of muzzling Marathi literary production. As we know, the medieval period, the medieval centuries, from the 13th to the 17th are among the richest centuries of Marathi literary production. It does not happen in a particular kind of courtly framework. The patronage of Marathi is heavily administrative in all the Deccan sultanates. In fact, Marathi begins as a kind of second language of the administration outside the core Marathi regions from the 16th century itself, as I said. But the literary production happens extensively outside.
Thank you. The next question goes, Sagar asks, archives are termed as sites of violence. Please comment.
Wow, this is a big question, but you know, taking just the small sort of household archive that I have looked at, you know, it is definitely kind of useful to apply a lot of the recent kind of critiques of archives that have been made about how archives kind of enable certain kinds of voices and do not allow certain kinds of voices to emerge in them and make them available for a kind of standard historical narrative. And I think that is true for this household archive as it is for any kind of archive, especially one kind that we might you know, sort of conceptualize in fairly conservative or kind of standard terms, as in written documents which are preserved in particular sort of state mandated or state institutional kind of frameworks. One of the things that this critique of archives as sites of violence has done is then to expand the domain of what an archive can mean, right? I mean, what are the different ways in which these archives, which only say allow certain kinds of elite male, you know, upper caste, so-called upper caste or elite voices in them, and how we might actually kind of recover these suppressed voices from them, whether it is at all possible to recover these voices from them, and how we might also then think about decolonizing these archives, or how we might think about democratizing or expanding the very notion of archives. So yes, I think archives are sites of violence, not only in that, you know, there is a lot of warfare and sort of extraction and violence that is typically kind of you know, preserved or documented in these sources or materials, but also that they are necessarily incomplete in the picture of the past that they can show us, and that is you can say a kind of violence that is necessary to critique and unpack.
Thank you. Bhavna Mehra has a question. She says, I have a generic question. Language remains currency in the modern era. It perpetrates culture and assigns territory and power. Is this flattened language imposition succeeding? Is it detrimental for the culture?
You know, in that, language is a form of social capital, a form of cultural capital, and is necessarily therefore tied to structures of power, structures of hierarchy and inequality, and access to this language then as currency necessarily perpetuates or you know, allows for the reproduction of certain kinds of hierarchy and so on, right? Language as a threat to culture is also something that requires, I think, a very careful contextualization, right? I mean, in that there are languages that in particular contexts are under threat from larger global languages and so on. And then in particular regional or local contexts, so they too can reproduce their own sort of hierarchies and suppress or act as kinds of oppressors of smaller cultural expressions and so on. One of the great sort of challenges and exhilarating sort of experiences of working with language is precisely kind of grappling with this hierarchy and trying to understand exactly what we mean by which language and what application of it in what context, because all languages kind of operate in a multilingual environment. And I think keeping that in play helps us actually situate what exactly we mean by currency and what we mean by culture, what we mean by kind of the oppression or the celebration of particular forms through linguistic expressions. But I think this is the kind of broad, answer that I would give. It really depends from context to context, and that's one of the reasons why I've also kind of specified microhistories of multilinguality, because these kinds of large blanket statements about language immediately kind of become problematic once you kind of start taking a closer look.
Thank you, Prachi. And the next question is related. It goes, what do the documents from this specific archive have to say about the prevailing gender and caste hierarchies?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for asking this question. You know, I think it ties back to the earlier question about archives as a site of violence, right? I mean, in a way, this archive is so rich and so, gives us so much information about certain kinds of commodities and transactions and so on. But it is actually a very, very partial look. This particular archive, I have not found any sort of references to female members of the family, say, or explicit references to caste in the household archive itself. In some household archives that have been published, in the Shivacharitra Sahitya volumes or in the Marathanchi Itihasachi Sadhane volumes, similar kind of household archives, you do find references to occasional female members of the family who want to take up a hereditary Kulkarni or Deshpande position, after the death of their husbands or their sons and so on. And their names emerge in the correspondence. But these particular household archives of Desais or of landed chiefs and so on are necessarily of either sort of Brahmin officials or of sort of Maratha or similarly elite families and so on. And the references to caste relations and so on figures kind of very, very obliquely or implicitly in the kinds of revenues or emoluments that they receive at particular fairs and festivals and so on. And it has to be corroborated with other records in the Peshwa Daftar and so on. So the household archive, it depends again on from area to area, but in this particular one, I have not really found much that tells us about gender and caste relations, apart from the fact that they don't figure, they are a silence in the archive. So it's really kind of useful to think about its language politics in this sense as well, rather than that kind of social dimension.
Thank you, Prachi. Talking of absences and invisibilities, perhaps we can move on to the next question, which says, what is the accountability of a state government in preservation of archival materials today? Question comes from Tukaram.
I'm not sure what you mean by accountability. If you mean responsibility, then yes, I think our state governments can and should do much more in making archives of different kinds, available more easily, either in their paper format or digitally to researchers and scholars across the board. Maharashtra has one of the richest, medieval and early modern archival heritage. But for all regions, I think this applies. I think yes. I mean, I would not disagree with the fact that state governments should take a greater responsibility, but also not just in preserving them, but on making them properly accessible to researchers like you and me.
I don't think there are many more questions here. Let's just wait for a minute or so if there are any questions coming in. Yeah, I don't think there's questions. With your permission, shall we conclude the program, Prachi?
Yes.
Okay, one question comes from Bhavna, or a comment. She says, Maharashtra has a lot of visible history in cities and towns. Archives in museums may not be read as well. How can these archives be popularized? Public outreach.
Can you just repeat that?
Sure, yes. Bhavana asks, Maharashtra has a lot of visible history in cities and towns, and archives in museums may not be read as well. So how can these archives be popularized?
One of the really interesting things about the emergence of a modern historical imagination in Maharashtra is that the effort was taken by a lot of individuals with the sort of dint of their own sort of resources and energies and so on. And I think that tradition has continued in Maharashtra, despite the fact that we also have a very sort of large and extensive state archiving system. There are many, many small archives and museums and so on, and it is really testimony to the sort of rich interest in local and regional history across different sections of the population. And again, I think what is really interesting about it is that it is very, very active in a regional public sphere. So within a kind of Marathi public, or within Marathi publics, different kinds of Marathi publics, there is enormous discussion about archival materials, where these might be. Even, I mean, I have been in this field for many, many years, and I still go to Facebook groups like Itihas Samshodhak, and I'm excited when I find so often new collections and archives coming to light over there. So I think there are sort of channels and publics through which these are made available. It is really for a larger public, across the country to take a greater interest in the language and learn these scripts and sort of historiographies as well, and then delve into this very exciting regional public. Because only then can its vibrancy, I think, be actually kind of made fully apparent, although, I mean, as we just finished this massive global Maharashtra conference over the last week, and we had scholars from all around the world presenting work in multiple disciplines for several different eras in history. So there is an awareness within a kind of scholarly world, but in terms of its public audience, it tends also to attract those who are aware of the language and the script and so on.
So with that, we come to the concluding part of the Infosys Prize lecture this evening. Thank you, of course, Prachi Deshpande, Professor Prachi Deshpande from Kolkata, who graciously joined us this evening and delivered a lecture on microhistories of multilinguality. Thank you, Prachi. Heartfelt thanks.
Thank you. It's my pleasure, and thank you very much again to Savitri Bai Phule, Pune University, and to the Infosys Science Foundation.
Right. And finally, yes, of course, thanks to the Infosys Science Foundation and Savitribai Phule Pune University for coming together and hosting this program and offering this great, great opportunity for all of us to listen to what Prachi has to say and give us the benefit of her primary research, which we are very, hoping very much will come in the book format very soon, Prachi. Right. Thanks are due to all our viewers, listeners as well. And with that, this program comes to its conclusion. Thank you, Prachi. Thanks, all of us here. Thanks.